We usually talk about insulin resistance as being a condition that affects mainly your muscle and your liver, because those are the two tissues that are most responsive to changes in diet. And we know that insulin resistance also affects your brain, and it can affect your brain profoundly. You guys know more about that than any human beings on the planet. So let's start at the top. What causes insulin resistance of your brain?
So for a long time, they actually didn't know, or they didn't think that insulin was active in the brain. For some reason, they thought that it was a completely different process. And this had to be proven through tissue studies, to postmortem studies, and then through newer techniques such as exosomes. Now we know that insulin is a major contributor and is involved in brain metabolism and homeostasis and energy metabolism in the brain. And there are two ways that the brain gets insulin. One is extrinsic, meaning that the insulin from outside of the body actually gets through the blood-brain barrier, binds to specific receptors, and then gets into the blood, into the cerebrospinal fluid, and then the brain cells use the insulin or are affected by insulin. Another way is, now we know, is that the brain itself actually creates an endogenous or insulin of its own. So those are the two ways that it actually receives it. Now, every cell in the brain don't use insulin the same way. And insulin has multiple functions in the body, but especially so in the brain. In fact, we'll get into that as far as many other functions besides just glucose metabolism that it does. But what happens in the brain is pretty much, as far as insulin resistance is concerned, the same thing as it happens in the periphery. So I think the first thing to do is say, what is insulin resistance? Insulin resistance is when the cells do not recognize insulin. Insulin is everywhere, but doesn't bind to the cell receptor. I mean, that's a blunt definition, but that's basically it. And for neurons, it's critical because, as we know now, glucose is its main source of energy. Why is that important? Because the most active, by far, exponentially active organ in the body is the brain. We've said this many times, this 3-pound organ, which is 2% of body's weight, consumes as much as 25 to 30% of body's energy. It needs energy continuously. In fact, it needs energy while you're sleeping. In fact, it does some of its best job when you're sleeping. So that energy has to come to the brain efficiently and effectively. I'm going to touch on it a little bit, but then we'll talk about it later. When people talk about ketosis and ketogenic diet and things of that nature, they don't recognize the long-term effect of even slight bit of inefficiency of energy metabolism in the brain. Yes, you might have short-term gain, but if the way energy is not metabolized perfectly in the brain, that has profound consequences long-term. Although we say all the organs are pretty much the same, I'm sorry, the brain is a little different. It's metabolism, it's energetics, it's long-term effect, all of that is a little different. So as far as that's concerned, I took that short question and made it long, but insulin resistance becomes even more important and more profound when it comes to this amazing organ.
So one of the things that you actually just mentioned, you said the brain produces its own insulin.
Yes, there is some evidence.
That's phenomenal.
Yes.
It is. There's some evidence based on some animal studies and some samples of neurons in a petri dish. They've actually seen the DNA or the RNA that produces insulin. They've also seen some factors that are precursors of insulin in the brain. We don't have solid evidence for that, but there are multiple lines of research that shows that insulin can be created in the brain.
But the short question answer is that it's much more complex. It's much more involved than people previously thought. And you have the different kind of receptors for insulin. Yes, there are different levels of insulin binding. Yes, there are certain parts of the brain that are more dependent or more sensitive to insulin, such as hippocampus.
Right.
What is hippocampus? Memory center. Why is it that the memory center is affected so early, along at the same time as insulin sensitivity is affected in the brain? So there are, that level of sensitivity, we're learning more and more about the brain and its interaction with insulin and the effect of insulin resistance.
We're also learning how when there is a transient increase in insulin levels in the periphery, say, for example, after a meal, there's a slight increase in insulin because it's secreted by the pancreas. That insulin actually gets transported into the brain through the blood-brain barrier. The blood-brain barrier is a tight junction between, you know, the endothelium or the lining of the arteries that only allows certain things to go. But if this high insulin level is maintained for a long time, so in chronic hyperinsulinemic cases, these transporters or the receptors in the blood-brain barrier are down-regulated, so we don't have as many of them and not enough insulin actually goes. And so chronic hyperinsulinemia causes problems with transportation of insulin into the brain, and it causes the down-regulation of receptors in the brain as well, whether it's on the neurons and other cellular structures.
So there's, when it comes to the brain, it takes a two-hit. One hit is in the transport across blood-brain barrier, which is an incredibly difficult, you know, it's a sealed environment. It's hermetic, and as far as quantity of insulin and as concerned as well. So what we see peripherally is, you know, exponentially increase that in the brain.
Okay, so how would somebody know if they have insulin resistance in their brain?
So that's a little controversial. Not controversial is not the right term. It's difficult. So the way we have right now, they extrapolate. I mean, I hate that word because we extrapolate everything, and often we extrapolate wrong. Not just in general public, but in science. Just because A happens, then B follows. So what up to now, majority of people actually use extrapolation. If there's insulin resistance in the periphery, it's assumed there's insulin resistance centrally. They've done some CSF, cerebral spinal fluid studies that actually correlated with that and corroborated that. They've used bad techniques such as HOMA-IR, which is a ratio and mathematical model between glucose and insulin. But in general, there seems to be some evidence, but we don't have real, you know, life direct evidence, or at least an easy way to look at the brain. But there is enough evidence correlationally from cadaver studies, from lab studies, as CSF studies, to show that whenever you have peripheral insulin resistance, it actually is also there centrally. Now there are some newer techniques, some really exciting techniques that we were reading recently.
Right. So the latest research actually shows that the brain secretes these packets of chemicals called exosomes. So exosomes are like, it's like an envelope with, you know, information inside it. And they're small enough to pass through the blood-brain barrier and be extruded into peripheral circulation. So through a blood test, one can actually tell whether there is brain insulin resistance. And from that information, they can actually see markers of Alzheimer's disease as well. But that's not the standard of care as of yet, and it's still in its research stages.
This, by the way, exosomes are the field of the future. So every cell has exocytosis, these packets that come out of the cell and are thrown out, and we thought that it was just garbage. Well, it's not. It's a part of, some of the exosomes are hormonal signals. Some of the exosomes are transport of information and material between cells. But a lot of the exosomes are just extrusions that that give you information about what's happening in the cell and different types of cell. You can actually tell what cell the exosomes come from, what type of cell, not a specific cell. And from that, it can tell you, you know, if there's a degenerative process going on early on, if there, you know, but even insulin resistance can be told from these exosomes. In the next 5 to 10 years, that will be the future of diagnosis of central nervous system diseases 10, 15, 20, 30 years earlier, because you're getting those signals much, much earlier from exosomes.
There's also some indirect ways of telling whether someone has brain insulin resistance through imaging. But again, that's only done through research procedures.
One of my favorite, I know we're geeks, but we have favorite imaging techniques. One of our favorite is PET scan, not these tech, you know, there are now, even in Loma Linda, we have this, you can actually look at inflammation in the brain with specific ligands that bind to inflammatory markers on the cells. And imagine how exciting that is. We actually want to do a study on traumatic brain injury and look at inflammation as well. But you can, but PET scan to me is especially FDG PET, which looks at glucose metabolism. You can tell even better than structural MRI for Alzheimer's and other diseases. I like the metabolic imaging because if there's a disproportion of lower glucose utilization in the parietal lobe and temporal lobe, it's a great marker of early signs of Alzheimer's because that's a specific pattern, right? If it's frontal lobe and temporal, it's a pattern for frontotemporal lobe dementia. And if it's occipital lobe, it's Lewy body disease. So we have imaging modalities that can give us signs of, you know, usage of glucose. So we have all these different methods that can tell us indirectly how we're using or not using glucose.
This is fascinating. Let's geek out here on these exosomes for a second. Are you saying exosomes are something that's only present inside of your brain, or exosomes are present inside of cells in the periphery as well? Any cell that actually does an exocytosis process?
All cells have exocytosis process, right? They lose parts of themselves to get rid of waste. Maybe red blood cells don't, because once they extrude the nucleus, then they have that 3 month cycle and then they die. I'm not sure about that. Although no, because even red blood cells, you can tell platelets, in any case, all cells have exocytosis. This is how we do things, Ayesha. Now we talk, we look at each other, we come up with an answer.
But it's really interesting in the field of neurology and neuroscience because, you know, for a long time, it's obviously when somebody wants to diagnose brain diseases, if it's beyond our reach from imaging, we have to have a sample of the brain. So, you know, a lot of people actually would go through biopsies of the brain, which is very invasive and can actually damage the brain during the procedure. But having samples of the brain extruded into circulation, and for us to have the technology to kind of break it down and take a look at it and see, you know, what the brain is doing as far as metabolism, as far as its neurodegeneration or just, you know, structural issues are concerned, it's fascinating and very, very interesting field.
Because it's almost like a mini cell, isn't it? So it's a part of the cell wall just opened up and became another little packet.
Just kind of,
On its surface are markers that tell you where it came from, what kind of cell it came from. Inside it is the, you know, ecosystem of the cell where it came from. So it tells you what's going on inside the cell. Now, you have to have techniques that can separate it out, tell you which cells are coming from brain, which cell, what cell type in the brain, or any organ in the body for that matter. And then what's inside it. I mean, that's remarkable. That's where we are at this point. But experimentally, as I have to say.